And Jeffrey, let me ask you a question, because Republicans do have a point when they say somebody, sometimes they unfairly say it was Senator Feinstein, but somebody leaked this to The Intercept and then to other people in the media to force this coming out, that it wasn't Republicans who outed her, it was somebody, likely a Democrat. And let's be honest, the motive was probably to stop Kavanaugh, not to have justice prevail.
Probably true. So what? I mean, you know, it came out in a disorderly way. It came out. She's testified under oath that he sexually assaulted her. I mean, the difference between the procedural machinations about how this story came about, I predict, for what it's worth, will be forgotten very quickly. The point is the substance. Did she tell the truth about what Brett Kavanaugh did to her? And if I could just add one thing about this metaphor that keeps coming up about, you know, the sort of criminal justice model of, said, Brett Kavanaugh, you know, there isn't proof beyond a reasonable doubt that he did it. He's entitled. This is not, I think Dianne Feinstein said this at the beginning, this is not a criminal trial. This is a job interview. Is there proof beyond a reasonable doubt that Brett Kavanaugh assaulted Ms. Ford? I don't think so. This is a job interview. If someone said to you, you know, we're looking to hire a babysitter, but he was accused by three different people of sexual assault, would you hire this babysitter to serve for the next 30 years as the babysitter for your kids? I mean, that, I think, is the question here, not should he be put in prison.
Joe?
But what's going to happen, what will really matter, is what's going to come in just a matter of minutes. How well he defends himself. He can suggest, compartmentalize what you all just saw. You might find her to be very credible. You might find her to be the nice lady that so many people are saying on the Republican side. But what he wants people to do is set that aside and listen only to him. He's not, you had asked earlier, will he attack her? He's not going to attack her. He's probably not even going to try to minimize what she says happened to her, but he's going to try to separate himself into a whole nother sphere and say, pay attention to me, pay attention to my character. Just what he said earlier in some of the prepared statements, it's not in my character to do this. It's against my religious beliefs to do this. And he's going to try to make his case independent of what we just saw, because he can't undercut it.
And then the Republicans have to hope that the standard laid out by Lindsey Graham, that they can sell that to Jeff Flake, to Ben Sasse, to Susan Collins, and to Lisa Murkowski. Mm-hmm. That is their argument. They understand, read your inbox, everyone at the table. They have up to this point lost in the court of public opinion. They know that. They don't think, even if Brett Kavanaugh is telling the truth, even if he gives an effective performance, the best they can do is a draw. Look at what all the Republicans are saying, because they did find Professor Ford compelling. They did find her human. They did find her speaking in a way that most likely connects with people that matter most outside of Washington. But what matters most to Brett Kavanaugh right now are five or six Republicans inside of Washington. And Ms. Mitchell's being savaged in social media right now by the president's supporters, other conservatives on social media.
We're not being tough enough.
They think she did a terrible job. However, what her supporters are saying, and others who are involved in the strategy, is that her goal was to be able to go into a room and get all the Republicans in a room after and say, Senator Flake, yes, she was sympathetic. She has no corroborating witnesses. Brett Kavanaugh is an appeals court judge. There have been six FBI investigations. He's an esteemed person. You're a Republican. You must support him. But there's a big jury and there's a small jury. The question is, the Republicans concede they lost the big jury, at least so far today. Can they keep the small jury?
I'm with the Trump supporters on this one. She did do a terrible job. I mean, you know, yes, she had a difficult job.
You're talking about Rachel Mitchell.
Rachel Mitchell. I mean, there are problems with her testimony, which Lindsey Graham did in about 30 seconds.
Right.
And she spent all the time talking about, you know, who paid for the polygraph and whether she liked to fly around the country. I mean, that was irrelevant stuff. She could have talked about
it. They hope not, though. It's irrelevant to you, and it's probably irrelevant to most people at home. What they're hoping is that with that small group of Republicans, they can plant the seeds that the Democrats are paying for this. Feinstein convinced her to hire that lawyer. And they're trying to keep the Republicans in the tribe. We live in a town of tribes. They're trying to keep Susan Collins, Jeff Flake, Lisa Murkowski, and Ben Sasse, Republicans most likely to leave the tribe, most interested in leaving the tribe. They're trying to keep them in the tribe.
But isn't it better to keep the tribe together with good evidence?
But, Jeff, you're assuming that she's ineffective because her goal was to uncover information. If, as Jake indicated at the very beginning, there was blaring absences of facts and you don't uncover a lot of information, you didn't get to the meat of the matter. And so if that was the intention of hiring her, not only for the optics politically, not to have the aggressive people talking about, are you a scorned woman or a rotomania coming back, 27 years later in some way, then she did not get information that would have illuminated a lot of issues. And in that respect, I bet people who coordinated with her and talked about what her role would be today found her quite effective at not uncovering more information. Now, as a prosecutor, I agree. I wouldn't have approached it in this way, and I would have uncovered more information and gotten to the heart of the matter easier. But that's because my goal would have been a fact-finding mission. Perhaps hers was different.
Well, and I think what upset Lindsey Graham from listening to him is that he feels that the Republicans were ambushed on this, that they could have been told about this earlier, and had they been told about it in August earlier, and, you know, he didn't talk about the fact that Dr. Ford wanted to keep this private, and obviously it was leaked in some way, but that they were... that they were completely ambushed. And he said, if you really believe we needed an investigation, if you had told us then, we could have had it. And he doesn't want to reward people for playing a political game, and called her a victim just as much as Brett Kavanaugh. So his fury is really directed at the Democrats on this, and he believes they're playing a political game. However, Democrats could argue... it is tactical, but Democrats could argue, what did Mitch McConnell do with Merrick Garland? Was that a political game, keeping his nomination on hold and then having it disappear? So, you know, raw politics here, absolutely. And I think, you know, Graham thinks it was a setup, and the setup worked as far as we saw, until we see Judge Kavanaugh and see how he comports himself.
It's shocking to think of politics taking place in the United States Senate.
I know.
The format clearly did not work for Rachel Mitchell and the Republicans. Every 5 minutes, she was interrupted by a speech from a Democratic senator, and then she'd have to pick up her questioning after that, not necessarily conducive to the type of questioning she was trying to pursue.